morning, our passage of text comes from Luke chapter 9, verses 37 through 43. So I'm going to go ahead and read that out loud. It says, "The word of the Lord. On the next day, when they had come down from the mountain, a great crowd met him," him being Jesus. "And behold, a man from the crowd cried out, 'Teacher, I beg you, look at my son, for he's my only child.' And behold, a spirit seizes him, and he suddenly cries out. It convulses him so that he foams at the mouth, and it shatters him and will hardly leave him. And I beg your disciples to cast it out, but they could not. And Jesus answered, 'O faithless and twisted generation, how long am I to be with you and bear with you? Bring your son here.' While he was coming, the demon threw him to the ground and convulsed him. But Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit and healed the boy and gave him back to his father. And all were astonished at the majesty of God." Let me pray. Father, this morning may we see your majesty in your word through the actions of our Lord and Savior. This is his name we can pray. Amen. This morning I do want to talk about the majesty of God. And I appreciate the opportunity to get out of the administrative rigors of life here and come up here to exposit the word. Majesty, majestic. I've had the chance to see some things in my life that I would probably characterize as having a form of majesty. I've been able to stand atop the Swiss Alps in December and view an amazing mountain range. I've had the opportunity to stand at the base of the Eiffel Tower and look up. I've had the opportunity to see the northern lights in the Alaskan sky. I've had the opportunity to be in a vehicle less than 100 yards from a majestic bull elephant on the plains of Kenya. But that is not the type of majesty that we're talking about this morning. For those are just a glimmer of the majesty of God. Our main idea this morning is that the Son left his glorified place on high to come provide redemption from evil. Now you may say, wait a minute. I thought we were going to talk about the majesty of God. Well, we are. The Son is God. The Father is God. The Spirit is God. So let's kind of summarize what's going on here and then break it down. So last week, Pastor Drew talked about this mountaintop experience that Jesus had with the three, Peter, James, and John. And they came down from that Mount of Transfiguration experience to find a failed attempt at healing a demon-possessed boy by the other nine disciples. It's the only child of a man who we don't even get the man's name. This man begs Jesus to intercede and to succeed where his disciples have apparently failed. The nature of the boy's possession was outward physical signs of an inward condition of slavery. He was seized, according to Mark 9:18 and verse 39 here. Convulsions and foaming at the mouth, muscle spasms resulting in grinding of his teeth and muscle locking. We find that in the Mark account. And also in the Mark account, covered with scars and made deaf and dumb. And this was a massive physical expression of what was going on inside this boy. So then the question is, why could the disciples not do what they had done back in chapter 9 when Jesus sent them out giving them the ability to heal diseases and power over the demons. And we also have to understand, what do we learn about Jesus, the Son, in this passage? So our first point is that the majesty of Jesus extends grace to cover our failures. Jesus had just had this Christological high point, and that's a fancy word of just referring to his Christ, his Messiah-esque-ness, to throw a word out there. This high point at the Transfiguration, where he has communed with the prophets of old, and he has been affirmed by the Father out loud. There was this sense of a sliver of seeing Jesus' majesty above. And then Luke pens this narrative of an immediate, I'm talking chronological immediacy, the next day, an immediate display of his majesty below. That is, in its veiled earthly form. They've come down from the mountain to find this distraught father, an enslaved son, and likely confused, quarreling disciples. This whole scene is going on here. So why have the disciples failed to exercise authority to cast the demon out this time? The answer lies in verse 41. In verse 41, it says, "O faithless and twisted generation." He's not directly referring to the Father. Sometimes it can seem like, oh, well, the Father made a statement, and then Jesus said, "O faithless, twisted generation." Jesus is referencing the crowd, and specifically kind of referencing his disciples as well. Understanding that their unbelief was the issue. Not because of a lack of trying. Likely they were doing some of those same things that they did back in chapter 9 when Jesus sent them out. But their problem was unbelief. Kent Hughes, in his commentary, makes this statement. Their problem was that they had subtly moved from trust in God to faith in the process. That is to say, faith in themselves, evidenced by their lack of prayer, as Jesus briefly notes in Mark's account. True prayer is an act of faith. They're coupled together. Jesus says, "How long am I to be with you?" It's a reminder that his earthly presence was temporary. It was yet another chance for the disciples to understand, hey, I'm not going to be around forever, so you can't count on me physically being with you in order to do the work that I have assigned you to do. But it was a reminder that in the absence of Jesus' presence and divine will, the disciples were powerless against evil. They didn't succeed. Now, there isn't an account of everything that they did, because that's not the important thing. The important thing is that they didn't succeed. You see, earlier on, and you may say, well, wait a minute, but in chapter 9 they went without him, and yet they had success. What's going on? Well, they went via his command and empowerment, according to his divine will. This time, it is the appearance that they were not acting according to faith and belief. They had trusted in the process. This reminds us that when we act in accordance with the Lord's divine will, he will empower us to accomplish it. He says so. But if we are acting and living outside of his will, we should not expect the same. Jesus knew here that the disciples, and also we, because we are disciples, would need a helper. He tells the disciples this in John chapter 15. verse 26. He says, when the Helper comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who proceeds from the Father, he will bear witness about me. Jesus is not going to be physically with them forever. There would come a time when he was not with them. And so he says the Helper is going to come because y'all need help, to use the Southern vernacular. And we can attest to that. We need help. When I try to go off and do it on my own, I fall on my face. And people say, oh, but your disciple could not. And then I realize, was I under my own power or was I trusting in the power of Christ? Jesus' disciples ask him in Mark's account, he said, why couldn't we cast it out? And he says to them, this kind cannot be driven out by anything but prayer. His statement of, O faithless and wicked generation, is a recalling of Deuteronomy chapter 32, verses 4 and 5, and verse 20, which reads this, the rock, his work is perfect, all his ways are justice. A God of faithfulness and without iniquity, just and upright is he. They have dealt corruptly with him. They are no longer his children because they are blemished. They are a crooked and twisted generation. And verse 20 says, and he said, I will hide my face from them, and I will see what their end will be. For they are a perverse generation, children in whom is no faithfulness. So when Jesus makes this statement, he's not just throwing something out there. He's recalling them to the sins and the faithlessness of their previous generations. It was a reminder to them of their need to look to the Lord, to the rock whose work is perfect, because their work was not perfect. The Father here considers the disciples representatives of Jesus, just as the Israelites were to be representatives of Yahweh to all of the nations. That's why God said, I choose you, not you choose me. I choose you to represent me to the nations. So the disciples were to be representatives of Jesus. Whoops. They didn't succeed. They were expected to do kingdom work. Kingdom work is providing physical, emotional, and spiritual restoration through verbal affirmation of the gospel as the source of freedom. That term kingdom work is kind of thrown out there a lot. We actually, the Creekside Academy course that we're in, going through the New Testament that Pastor Drew is leading, he brought up this idea about kingdom work as we were talking about the kingdom of God and what kingdom work is. Just because a Christ follower does something doesn't mean that it's kingdom work. You see, serving at a soup kitchen is kingdom work, likely if you only verbalize in whose name you are doing the work. You see, somebody who is not a Christ follower could serve soup, but they cannot do it in the name of Christ as they verbalize the name of Christ. Imagine this, okay? And hopefully this will kind of make my point. Imagine there's a keynote witness taking the stand in a courtroom. On this testimony of this witness, the defendant will be declared right or a fraud. So the witness has exactly what they need to provide proof in hand. They have a simple handkerchief that provides proof of the defendant's story. So the witness has this article with them. So the witness takes the oath, and then the prosecuting attorney says, please tell us in your own words what happened. How is the defendant to be declared right by your testimony? And then, suddenly the judge sneezes several times and is fumbling for a handkerchief, can't find anything. The witness pulls out the handkerchief, which has been passed down from generation to generation, given to the family by the defendant's ancestors, proving the connection that will declare the defendant right. But instead of describing its importance and how it can save the man's life, the witness simply hands the handkerchief to the judge and says, "God bless you," and steps down from the witness stand, feeling that their work is fully accomplished. I believe a lot of times this is what we do far too often when we meet civil and social needs while failing to make it verbally evident in whose name we do these things and what that means for the eternal position of the one receiving aid. The disciples were to do kingdom work in the name of the King, but they failed. And so you have a distraught father whose son has not been saved, is still enslaved to evil. You see, while Jesus was away revealing a measure of his glory, his disciples failed to continue to do the work that he had given them to do. I pray that would not be the case for us, that while he is away, that we would fail to do his kingdom work because we are attempting to do it of our own power, in our own will, in our own way that makes us feel comfortable. Yet we see here that the father of this boy recognizes the ability of Jesus even in the midst of the father's own inability. He can't do anything. The dad, he's tried everything. I know as a father, I'm sure there are many things that they're not recorded that he has tried to do to save his son, to help his son out of his current situation. It wasn't like, well, he's been dealing with this demon for years, and the first thing I've done, well, I might as well finally come and ask this guy's disciples to help. It says this boy has been, dealing with this since childhood, which means since he was little, and now he's older. And the father is distraught. He's at the end of his rope. He doesn't know what else to do. And so he goes to where he should have gone in the first place, the Son of God, who can provide deliverance, the one who has full authority. You see, those who believe, those of us who believe, still struggle with full belief at times. But Jesus can intervene even in the most difficult of circumstances. These symptoms that this son were displaying show a very difficult situation. But even more problematic is that this boy is the only son of this family. So who will take care of the family line after if the son is not fully restored? So it's not just that the son is in physical need, it's that the family is in need. Because in that day and age, if you did not have a son, did not have an heir, there you didn't have hope. That was the end. So who would restore the boy to health? Secondly, our second point is that the majesty of Jesus provides healing and salvation from evil. You see, this boy was locked away inside of himself, unable to have control over his own actions. He was a slave to evil. Note the contrast here with the transfiguration, that Peter wanted to stay, didn't he, last week? He wanted to build tents and just hang out. He's like, this is really cool. If you read between the lines, Peter says, this is really cool. Right? Let's just hang out here. This is awesome. I can't imagine being anywhere else. Can't we just keep this feeling going? Can we not leave? Have this glorious campsite. We had a good time last night, right? I can't say that it was, let's build tents and never leave, right? But it was a good time. But Peter was like, no, let's not leave. This is awesome. Stay here. But yet, here is a boy who could not choose to leave his current circumstances. It's kind of as if Jesus was showing Peter why they can't stay on the mountaintop. There are many slaves to set free. And Peter didn't, he had the here and the now. He didn't have the long game in mind that Jesus had. He wasn't thinking of, he didn't even know about this boy, but yet Jesus did. It's a reminder that freedom comes through Christ, not through his disciples, past, present, or future. It's not the power of my words or the genuineness of my heart, but it's the power of the Spirit who sets men free. I can save no one. I can tell them. I can be a witness to the one who saves. But I can be rejected in spite of how great and wonderful my arguments might be. Jesus was. But he is the only one who can save from being enslaved to evil. This idea of being a slave to evil is expounded upon by Paul in Romans chapter 6, verses 6 through 7. He says that we know our old self was crucified with him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so we would no longer be enslaved to sin. For one who has died has been set free from sin. And he's not talking about physical death there necessarily, but he's talking about spiritual death, the death to my natural self, that we have been crucified with Christ. And crucifixion encompasses dying, right? Because that's what happened to Jesus and everybody else who was ever crucified, right? Jesus wasn't the only one. But he is the only one who was crucified for our sins to set us free. That is how we are freed from sin. And then Peter also, in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 19, Peter is talking about those who reject Christ, who cling to the old ways of self-reliance. It says they promise freedom, but they themselves are slaves of corruption. For whatever overcomes a person, to that he is enslaved. And last time I checked, slavery does not allow for self-actualization, to use a modern-day term. It doesn't allow me to make my own decisions. I'm told what to do and when to do it and where to do it and how long to do it. I am not of my own free will. It is not as if it's just my job. It is slavery with no hope of end, yet Christ. That is the only hope. It is only through the personal intervention of the triune God in the person of Jesus that we can be granted freedom from sin and eternal death. It is only. There is no other way. The law of Moses did not save. It does not save. The Ten Commandments do not save. It is only through the personal intervention of the triune God in the person of Jesus that we can be granted freedom from sin and eternal death. It is exclusive because God said so. In John chapter 8, verses 28 through 32, Jesus is speaking. He says, "When you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am He, that I do nothing of my own authority, but speak just as the Father taught me. And He who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, for I always do things that are pleasing to Him." And as He was saying these things, many believed in Him. So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed Him, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples. And you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." What truth? Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, the life." That truth will set you free. Not just true facts. Don't say, "Well, I know the truth about this person, so that's going to set me free from them." No, the truth is a person in Christ. He alone can set you free. You see, this intervention of God is why we gather here to celebrate. Why else would we be here? Right? We might be riding motorcycles. Apropos timing, right? Amen, right? We might be fishing. We might be attending a ball game. We might be sleeping in. We might be having Eggs Benedict, which sounds really good. We might be doing many other things, but we gather here to celebrate the Son and this intervention of God in our lives. But we don't stay here. Kent Hughes expounds on this. He says, "Personal and corporate worship takes us onto the Mount of Transfiguration where we see Jesus shine. Evangelism brings the Shekinah glory down into the dark valleys where needy souls suffer under the cruelty of sin." This in turn reminds us of the incomparable wonders of God's grace and encourages further obedience and worship. There are dark valleys. There are people who are enslaved to sin. That's why we don't just stay here. I remember there were numerous times, whether it was in high school with a youth group trip, or whether in college on a retreat with the campus ministry, at that time Campus Crusade, now it's called Crew, that I was on, or a mission trip. It's like, wow, this feeling, right? This gathering, oh, it's just so great. But you can't stay there because there's a world enslaved to sin. That is to remind us of who we are obeying. It is to encourage us. We come here to encourage one another, not just with a, "Hey, how you doing? I'm fine." Because I know sometimes if you ask me how I'm doing and if I said, "Oh, okay, I'm fine," that is a lie, right? Because I'm a real person. I've got life. I've got a job. I've got relationships, right? I've got weeds that grow, right? I've got limbs that fall from trees and I'm not ready to cut them down, right? I got a driveway that might wash out because of the rain. I'm not always doing fine. We gather together to encourage one another in order to go out and do the kingdom work, but not by ourselves. This isn't, "Hey, let's gather together and we'll see you next week." This is gathering together in corporate worship so that we can go out together and continue to encourage one another as we are going in true kingdom work. Our final point here: the majesty of Jesus is seen in the exercise of divine authority. You see, the demon recognizes Jesus and tries to display his authority over the boy. The thing, it, is squirming. It is trying to hold on for ever dear life to what it wants. Do not take this from me, it is mine. I can just, in my human creativity, as Adam talked about this morning, in my human creativity mind, I'm thinking this is what the demon is thinking. Take this not from me. And yet, when Jesus rebukes the demon, it has to let go immediately. It didn't let go for anything that the Father had tried up to this point. It didn't let go for anything the disciples had done up to this point. But Jesus rebuked the demon, which is an exercise of authority in saying no, in essence. And the demon obeyed. You see, his authority was not different on the mountain when he was communing with the saints than it was in the valley with the sinners. That's not a different authority. But what was visible on the previous day to the three, Peter, James, and John, those three disciples, it was now apparent to the people down below. And I'm talking about mountain to valley because they came down the mountain. The glory of God and his awesome compassion was shown through his works of power and deliverance. You see, it wasn't, oh, Jesus is up there on the mountain and wow, authority and king, and that's amazing. And then he came down here and it's like, eh. That's a different authority. He does not change. It was just that his authority below, it was veiled. And yet he exercised it supremely. Jesus healed the boy, it says, and then, and I don't know how, I missed this so many times when I read this until this point. It says he gave him back to his father. It doesn't just say he healed him and then everybody had a party, right? It says, and he gave him back to his father. Jesus here restored the relationship of father and son. It's a reminder that Jesus came to restore us and give us to the Father, to the Heavenly Father. Jesus, in John chapter 14, he was speaking to his disciples, specifically answering a question of Thomas. He says, and you know the way to where I am going. And Thomas says, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? Something that we would probably say ourselves. Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, you do know him, and you have seen him. He is the only way to the Father. He is the one that can give us to the Father after restoring us, redeeming us from evil. For there is no other way. In the same way that he restored this boy, he can restore us by his divine will. If he so wills, so it will be. There is nothing that God wills that does not come to be. For if he so wills and it does not happen, he so ceases to be God. End of said discussion. Right? He can restore us. If he can restore this boy who is physically restrained and entrapped by evil, he can redeem me. Secondly, Jesus restored the family. He restored the future of the family here. Recall that this boy was the only son, therefore the heir, therefore the one who would continue the line. We kind of can remember that Abraham had a son who was given to him as the promise of the next great generation. Right? Look up in the heaven, see the stars? That will be your offspring. And then God gives him the son. He says, okay, now sacrifice him to me. And it might seem like, wow, what's going on here? But then God restores Isaac to Abraham. He says, I know you haven't withheld him from me. And God provides a sacrifice in the place. This son was restored, or excuse me, this son was given and restored to those who needed him, whose future freedom or slavery, because if they had no one to take care of the family, then their only choice was to be put themselves out to be servants to somebody to provide food for themselves. So this boy, it seems kind of unfair, but that's just the way it was. This boy represented freedom or slavery, independence or indenture servitude. That future was in doubt with the way that the son was currently existing. There was no hope for their future. You see, God cares about the family. He desires a family to be unbroken, though the effects of sin prevent the perfect continuance of the family state. And God cares about the family before brokenness, during brokenness, through brokenness. God restores through the redemptive power of Christ. Through the direct intervention of Christ, any sin is forgiven. Every sin is forgiven. His redemption is complete and utter to the uttermost. Jesus restores this family's faith in God. One of the great things about having a plurality of elders is having the ability to bounce ideas off of one another. And as I was discussing, Pastor Drew brought up a great point about that. There's a point about parenting here, and I felt like, well, duh, I have four kids. Why didn't I really think about this idea? But there's a great parenting point here. You see, the father has exhausted all reasonable measures to heal his son, and yet his son was still under the slavery of evil. Parents, there is no guarantee that if we simply do the right thing, discipline the right way, read the right books, adopt the right schedule, that our children will be healed, whether physically or spiritually. You see, it is not you who can provide salvation for your children. Your children need the same Jesus you do. And they must each individually accept that. It is a personal faith decision. It is not something I can pass down from generation to generation, from father to grandfather, or that would be weird, from grandfather to father to son, right? To son of that son. It's not an heirloom that we hand down. Salvation. Knowledge of God. His commandments, yes. We are told to pass those down. We are told to teach our children. But that knowledge does not save. It is Christ who saved. It is acceptance of his redemption. It is that conversion that saves. And each person individually must have that. So you see, we are reminded that better education, whether it be public, private, magnet or homeschool, the right extracurriculars, or any other thing will not ultimately prove salvific, that is, a work of salvation for our children. See, this father has cast himself onto the mercy of God and pleads for Christ to save his child. And then God graciously answers. I'm reminded that when I don't prioritize the church, that is, the gathered body, in my case, the gathered body of Creekside Fellowship, and the connection to my church family, Monday through Saturday, as well as Sunday. My children will never see its importance. This is not about checking an attendance box. We won't get to glory and God say, okay, let's see. Oh, good job, Chad. Perfect attendance button. Come on in. That doesn't exist. This is not about that. But I'm reminded, as Adam preached several weeks ago, where is my allegiance? If I consistently find reasons to avoid Sunday gatherings, to avoid other church-related activities, to never get together with church family members outside of church-sponsored functions, I'm declaring that my allegiance to the kingdom of Christ is at best secondary. I need to let my children see. You need to let your children see your need for Christ. This father is letting his son see his need for Christ. Sometimes as a dad, I want to have all the answers, right? Every once in a while, Dad, why is the sky blue? And they don't know. And they're like, well, because God painted it that way. Or, you know, or I get scientific and I try to have all the answers. And because my child doesn't know completely better, I can sometimes kind of embellish, right? As a father, I want my children to see me with all of the answers. I want them to say, wow, my dad can beat up your dad. No, not really. But I want my children to say, wow, my dad's cool, right? But my children need to see that I need Christ. They need to see that I cannot heal them from their spiritual need. And I cannot always physically heal them. They need Christ, for there will come a day when they leave my care, and they need Christ when I am not around. I'm also to recall that Jesus describes faithless and twisted generation. I do not want myself or my children to be found in that group. I can't help but think but Joshua and his line in the sand statement to the Israelites. To choose between the Lord and the gods of the Canaanites. He says in Joshua 24, now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and faithfulness. Put away the gods that your fathers served beyond the river and in Egypt and serve the Lord. And if it is evil in your eyes to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your fathers served in the region beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. It is a reminder that God cares about the family. He cares about my family more than I do. And as a father, I need to go to him and plead with him for the souls and the physical needs of my children. For he is the only one who can take care of those. So we come to a conclusion today, and I tried several different iterations, but then I found somebody who wrote one that was better, right? Wherever the Lord went, whether onto the Mount of Transfiguration or down to the troubled world below or onto Calvary's tree, he did the Father's will perfectly and displayed his glory. So 3 points of application, quick. Right? Because we got a baptism to get to. Number one, don't look to pitch your tent on the mountaintop, but accept what tomorrow holds to the praise of his majestic name. He has a plan. He knows what tomorrow holds. I don't. You don't. Secondly, don't look to yourself for the power or purpose in doing God's will. Look to Him who has both, who has all three, the power, the purpose, and the will. And then finally, don't look below, that is to things of this world, meaning things around us, things that are temporary, for ultimate authority, but look to the Lord for ultimate authority. For there's nothing in this world that has authority beyond Christ. He has all authority, and He told His disciples that.